heading up our panel tonight is Sara Batterby of Hifi Farms. Sara spent many years in advising, investing in, and managing companies. And since 2015, she has been working on her own venture, Hifi Farms, which is one of the premier cannabis brands operating out of Hillsboro, Oregon. And she will be a knowledgeable and very able guide through the panel discussion tonight. So please join me in welcoming Sara.
Thank you. Thank you. Just want to say happy International Women's Day. Female founders, very compelling statistics on how good we are at that, by the way. So it's really great to be here. Hifi Farms, I don't know if we were the first cannabis member of OEN, but we've been a member for about 6 months, I think. I love it. I would totally recommend it. And when Megan reached out and asked if, you know, she thought, if I thought it was a good idea to do a panel, we were like, that's a great idea. And I was like, okay, this is perfect. There's an opportunity to really showcase cannabis to maybe some people from outside of our community a little bit. How many people here are in the cannabis industry right now? Okay, so I'd say like 10 to 20% of you.
Liz.
So what I wanted to do was put together a group of people who could really kind of create a perspective around opportunities that are available in the industry, the differences between cannabis and some of the other industries that we're maybe used to being entrepreneurs in, which I came from a tech background and then finance, and a lot of you guys are entrepreneurs coming from all different sectors. Cannabis is a little different in some unique ways, and I thought it would be interesting to highlight that and also just give you kind of a little bit of a 101 about where we're at and what the cannabis industry is doing here in Oregon. So just very briefly to introduce these guys, Jesce Horton is a cannabis entrepreneur and founder. He has a company called Panacea Valley Gardens, which is a pretty significant cultivation operation. He's also the founder of the Minority Cannabis Business Association and has a very unique perspective on diversity in the industry. Ashley Preece-Sackett, she built one of the most successful cannabis testing facilities in Oregon and established probably the most well-respected cannabis testing lab brands in the state, which is Cascadia Labs. She then moved on from there to found Ethical Cannabis Alliance, which is kind of laying the groundwork and establishing standards for ethical business practices in cannabis, which is pretty awesome that on the very ground floor of this industry, we have people already being intentional about the values that we're deploying in the way that we build this new economy. And Dyana Patamia, I met Dyana as a kind of very fresh entrepreneur. She had a company called Titrate that was really based on a very deep exploration that she did into what we would term as the kind of new cannabis user. These are not people who have been smoking weed for years and years. Maybe they haven't used cannabis for a long time, and maybe they're feeling a little bit apprehensive and they're looking for products that are accessible, accessible to women, accessible to people who maybe didn't feel comfortable breaking the law, but now that it's legal, they'll try something. So she really thought through the whole new market, and she founded a company called Titrate, which she has since then sold to another company, actually my company, because I bought it. But I just thought that was a really interesting perspective for a founder who started a company, went through a very quick cycle to exit, and is now integrated into a larger company, and has really thought about this new market for cannabis, which is a little bit different. So what I wanted to do quickly was, I'm just gonna go straight into a very quick 2 years ago to today. So in October of 2015, Oregon legalized recreational cannabis via Measure 91. And my life has changed pretty drastically since then. I moved to Oregon in November of that year with no clue about cannabis. It was not on my radar. So a lot has happened, and we now have gone from a lot of celebration and excitement over the passing of this new law into a really well-regulated and operating industry, which has some significant challenges. But for each one of you guys, what I wanted to know was, compared to 2 years ago and today, how would you summarize what's happened in your worlds in the last couple of years?
Well, I have to summarize that. Well, let's see. So 2 years ago, I was finalizing my product line. I had all this marketing material that I had made myself. I was a one-woman show. And I went to my first Women Grow meeting. I was meeting all these people and doing a lot of networking and sort of getting a sense for what the cannabis industry even was, because I didn't know that I was actually going to enter that space until I attended a Women Grow meeting and was really inspired by it. And the business that I was already running at the time was quite complementary to shifting into cannabis and adding it as an ingredient. So I was navigating the regulations, doing this sort of grassroots movement through other medical patients and attending events that they were putting on and just sort of sharing the product. And it was very grassroots and quite easy to do, actually. And over the course of 2 years, as regulations came on board and the OLCC began to license the industry, the hurdles were much larger. And it was very difficult. In fact, there was 1 month specifically when the licensure sort of shifted into action that I couldn't operate at all. I just had to stop. And I didn't really have a plan in place for how I was going to quickly move into that. It was fun, and then it was hard.
Yeah, new regulatory, emerging, highly regulated market is some challenges.
2 years ago, I had just moved to Portland from Bend to launch Cascadia Labs in Portland. In Bend, we were a small 1,200 square foot mom and pop shop, funded from internal family seed money. And then when we launched in Portland, we had found investors prior to the new regulations that have just been put into place. So it was kind of this stage of build out before we launched our flagship facility of Cascadia Labs, an analytical laboratory. I'm not sure if y'all know the analytical requirements that oversee cannabis prior to the new regulations that rolled out in October. They were, comparatively speaking, minimal to what they are now. As of October 1st, they have changed drastically. And then once again, they continue to change because the industry is not able to support the overbearing robustness that OLCC and OHA has implemented. So this transition between us launching in Portland and today, this 2 years has been probably the most transitionary 2 years of the cannabis industry in Oregon. And so me personally, that has been a roller coaster. So that's kind of in a nutshell what has happened regulatory-wise. Personally, I have sold my portion of the company to launch something that's more endearing to me with my horticulture background and my passion for people and the planet, and launching this standard-setting body for cannabis.
This is easy, right? You see, just put up a sign and you get a couple jars and you put them in a glass, right? Right, exactly. I was on Craigslist figuring out how I can get a little glass container that I can use as my desk, and now it's completely, completely different. So I've learned a lot in these 2 years.
So I have a quick follow-up question that I'm curious about. Like, you talk about giving back, and this is a big thing in cannabis. It's as an industry, I'd say we're closer to the roots, our roots, and as like a social justice movement. That was not me. I have a background in business, but a lot of people in this industry were activists for years, and they still are really like deeply embedded in social justice and a value system that is very unique. And you say that, you know, one of the first principles in your thinking about business was, how are you going to give back? I mean, is that how you thought about your job before cannabis?
You know, I never did. My dream was always to find a passion where I could do it all at one time and find ways to really funnel it there at one time. And I knew that corporate wasn't it for me. I didn't have the passion there, so I never considered how do I use this to give back. And once I found myself in an industry that I was really passionate about, then it was almost like second nature. It's like, you know, doing what's right, doing what you're passionate about. Of course, you know, progressing yourself, but it was automatic for me that I had to also spend time giving back. And of course, as you mentioned, this industry, I think, is so deeply rooted in activism and human rights that it's very easy. It's almost second nature in this industry. And then you combine that with the fact that we're in Portland, Oregon, which I think is very much centered around human rights and caring for other people and the less fortunate. So it was a natural direction I felt like I needed to go.
So I'm veering a little bit off script here, which is not atypical, but Ashley, that makes me think about you, and you've been like a founder, you've raised money, you've sold a company, you've done these big things, and now you founded ECA. Do you think of yourself as primarily an activist or an entrepreneur?
Neither. I guess when I hear the word entrepreneur, I slate myself in that category because I've done a couple things that have accomplished what the meaning is. And then activist, by no means my background encompasses, and you know, being active in lobbying, maybe a little bit in the last 4 years, but ultimately Ethical Cannabis Alliance, which is a nonprofit and does have the mission of providing social justice and environmental stability within the cannabis industry, ultimately that is more of a sentiment, I guess you would say. And as Jesce was stating, a mission within my own soul and within the efforts behind me and the people that surround me to bring that to the table. So I guess the answer to that would be no. I don't put myself in either of those categories or ethical cannabis in either of those categories.
Okay, that's really interesting. I'm learning a lot. And
I just want to add one little thing, and that is that. In spirit of all this, I'm an herbal activist. So cannabis is the platform in my mind to sort of facilitate that movement because everybody's paying attention to it and it's the hot thing. But it's just an herb.
Yeah, awesome. So Dyana, I wanted to ask you. You have a unique experience. It's kind of like this dreamlike founder experience where you build a company and 15 minutes later someone comes along and buys it, right? Like that doesn't happen every day. So
you have a good advisor.
Yeah, thank you. But you built a really unique product and a really unique company and an offering. And what do you think it was about what you built that made it attractive as an acquisition target?
Well, I think after I spent a good year sort of getting the word out and sharing it with everyone, it became pretty clear that the marketplace was, well, in the cannabis industry, was hungry for something different, a new approach, something more approachable, and everybody's curiosities were going up. So, you know, parents were looking into using cannabis as a way to relax and unwind and sort of replace their alcohol content. And, you know, folks in their later years who used to smoke the cannabis from the 70s and it was pretty laid back were dabbling and finding that everything was really strong and not sustainable for them. And so they were looking for products that were gentler, milder, that they had more control over. And so that was my niche. I had a product that was filling this unique niche, and which was, by the way, microdosing the THC component and blending it with other herbs for a nice synergy and a flavorful experience. And so there was the innovation aspect. And also, I was a one-woman show, like I said, and I didn't have any partners. I didn't have any debt. Everything was a clean transition. And it was a product that complemented the direction and the ethics and the vibe of the company who wanted to acquire it. And it saved a lot of time in R&D and so forth on their end.
Yeah, that's great. So I want to take a little bit of a turn of direction. You know, one of the things that I find, regardless of the industry that you're talking about, one of the subjects that people seem super interested in is fundraising. And that's something that, you know, I, as CEO of Hifi Farms, I've basically spent the last 2 years fundraising. And I know, Jesce, you are deep in fundraising. And Ashley, you've done this before, and you're doing it again. And I just want to ask you, I know both of you have raised money successfully and you're currently raising money for your business. And what is the thing that you believe has made you kind of, has given you like at least a somewhat successful track record in doing this thing, which is like notoriously difficult to do?
Yeah, it is very, very difficult. I mentioned that my first entry into the industry was thinking that I was going to start a dispensary. I quit that job that I said I loved and I thought I needed with maybe about $20,000, and I thought I was going to use that to open a dispensary. Right. So I quickly realized after I quit that job that wasn't going to happen. And I got out there and just started maybe trying to raise money. And the first meeting that I had, the guy laughed at me when I said I was going to open a dispensary with $20,000, and he challenged me to open $100,000. And I walked out of that meeting and said, there's no way I'm ever going to be able to get $100,000 from someone. That was just monumental or just astronomical to me. And I just started taking it step by step. And I think that the one thing that got me through that process and is helping me to get to this next round where I'm raising money for a new project and is much more than I thought I ever could, you know, again, was just that passion, I think. And I think a lot of entrepreneurs in here know that the passion for what you're doing and the love for what you're doing every day will get you through a lot. And I think that it's gotten me through a lot of things that I didn't believe I could do. And of course, raising money was and is the most difficult of them all.
Ashley.
I would say that the key element for me that I've gathered is that you are a package. It's not your model, it's not your budget, it's not your logo. It includes all of those things as well as yourself and how you deliver those things. So if you're trying to fundraise, you include yourself as part of that package. You have to be reliable and you have to be responsible and you have to be trustworthy. And those things you can't make up. You either have those or you don't. Another important thing is that the fundraising that I've done, I never went out and looked for money. The money found me and my organizations. I was literally either at a booth pitching the idea I had already had, or at a conference pitching a slideshow to a group of people. And, you know, literally people walked up and started asking questions. And then a vetting process starts, and that's where you sell yourself as part of the package.
Yeah, this is the really interesting thing about cannabis. Like, there's no one in the world in cannabis or anyone who's going to tell you that fundraising is easy. It isn't. It's super hard. But it's a little easier in cannabis than it is in, like, tech. Like, the next widget is difficult to raise money for, but and I think that's because there's a massive amount of investor interest, and we're completely foreign to one another. Most cannabis entrepreneurs are first-time entrepreneurs and they've never raised money, and most cannabis investors are tech investors and they've never invested in cannabis. So these people are not buddies. And, you know, and even if you spend time around OEN, you spend time around OEF, like all of these organizations in Portland, the purpose of these organizations is really to bring together investors and entrepreneurs. And you guys have been networking with each other for decades. Everyone speaks the same language, you're all familiar with each other, you're all friends. It is not like that in cannabis. And so in cannabis, if you, like Ashley said, if you can create a business and represent yourself in a way that is relatable to investors, and be competent in your knowledge of your business and all the rest of it, you're actually a member of a fairly small cannabis club that looks not totally terrifying to a tech investor. So it's kind of an interesting opportunity for people coming in from other sectors to start businesses in this space and have a really good chance of raising money because maybe they have a business background that's relatable to a traditional investor. That's one of the things that made Hifi Farm successful was we were able to raise money because I was able to relate to investors. I'd spent years of my career networking with them. I think that's interesting for cannabis. But this is no joke. Like the idea that our entire capital market system can be completely thrown off kilter by one response to a question by Sean Spicer, who's, I mean, it doesn't matter how competent or not this administration is or anything. The situation that we're in as an industry is untenable. The fact that there would be insecurity like that is ridiculous. And so I don't think Jeff Sessions is going to do very much of anything about cannabis. I think he's got bigger problems than us. And he would have to change a lot of laws to fund the feds to go after legally regulated businesses in states that have passed laws based on voters to have these cannabis economies. But it freaks people out. It's going to make it difficult for us to raise money, and that's a bummer.
I think the one thing we also, even more so, because I agree with that from a financial, from a business perspective, I think in a lot of ways he's inconsequential in what he feels about the industry. There's a lot of things and barriers that he has to break down. But what I think we have seen is from a criminal justice aspect, the federal government has the ability to step in a lot of these different cases that happen in the states. I think we may have seen recently in Oregon, there was a kid, maybe 15 years old, that had cannabis at his school, but that school happened to be on Native American land, which was federal land, right? And there was a real question, even at that point, of whether or not they were gonna go after and prosecute this kid for having cannabis, even with our old attorney general. Now we have Jeff Sessions. A lot of those cases are gonna be popping up and even bigger, right? But even as small as something like that, and the question is, you know, he does have the ability to say, yeah, we will pick that up, we'll pick this up. And I think those are the areas where we have to be a little bit more worried.
I agree, yeah. And actually, I'm just going to use that as an opportunity to jump into a question that I had for you. And this is a real thing. Like, you know, Jeff Sessions brings up real and important issues about civil rights and diversity and protections in our country. And cannabis is a really interesting, there's some really interesting contradictions. And I just want to ask you, like, as a person of color in cannabis and as a person of color who's worked in kind of corporate America and everything, are you able to kind of articulate what cannabis is like for brown people?
You know what? I think it's very scary from the outside looking in, because outside of the industry where we do have more of the comfort of activists and people who have been consuming cannabis for a long time and people who aren't necessarily the friends of law enforcement, right? I think in the industry we have that pocket of people, but on the outside looking in, before I got into the industry, I was arrested 3 times for cannabis possession, 1 time even for a seed. I had to drop out of college because I lost my scholarship for a small 1 gram cannabis possession charge that I had when I was living in Florida. My father spent 7 years in prison for cannabis, mainly for cannabis, when I was a child. I have, and I think a lot of people of color have a really visceral reaction to cannabis, the cannabis industry, out of fear that we will be the ones that get targeted. And if you look at, those of you who don't know, if you look at statistics around the country, the usage of cannabis is among, really equal amongst white people, black people, people of color in general, but the arrest rates are astronomically higher for people of color, especially African American males. And when you look at that, it's not just the arrest, but it's about spending the time in prison. It's about what happens to your kids. Are they going to have a good chance after you get out of prison? When my father got out of prison, luckily, they weren't doing the real extensive background checks that they are right now. So he was able to get on with the company and rise up, right, for 30 years and able to make a way. But we have a very different reaction. So I think coming into it, my reaction has been different. As I mentioned, there's a lot of friends, I think, in the industry who understand this issue, who know about these statistical, the statistical imbalance as it relates to some of these things. So it's been good, honestly. I think there has been a lot of support. I found a lot of friends in the industry. A lot of people I know now, I kind of were some of the people I met when I first got into the industry, and they've helped me to propel and to grow my, you know, grow my business and grow my mindset. So it's been an amazing place as opposed to the engineering world, where I would say that there were more initiatives, there was more diversity language, there were more set processes around how they were going to go after it, but I think there were a lot more lip service in that regard, a lot more checking off that box because that's what our shareholders want, that's what we should do. And I think in cannabis, even though there is not enough diversity, even though there are still there's still a long, long way to go, I think our path to get there will maybe have less bumps and less barriers than it has in the corporate and the traditional business.
Yeah. And I mean, that brings me on to, you know, the issue of diversity as it pertains to women. Oregon actually has the highest level of diversity in ownership and management of cannabis companies to any other legal cannabis state. We have 44%. That's a lot. It's actually exactly double the representation of women in Fortune 500 companies at like the management, ownership, and board level. So we're killing it. 44% is amazing. So I wanted to ask you, Dyana, like you both have been a female entrepreneur. You designed a product that was really very focused on women as well. You know, why do you think cannabis represents a unique opportunity for women?
Well, let's see. So for me, it always goes back to herbalism. And the cannabis is, you know, aside from the fact that it's now called recreational, the thing that cannabis became famous for across the world was helping people medicinally and nurturing conditions and diseases and being very therapeutic. And these are all qualities that come naturally for most women. It's just innate. It's something that women show up for in their families to do. And so cannabis is just this natural complement to that energetic. And the other thing I would say is that you have to have a lot of, you have to have thick skin and you have to be tenacious and resilient to really be successful in the way the industry is set up now is not easy at all. And I personally believe that these are qualities that women have down as well. we do. So let's see, other than those two things, the approachability of it all. So women, we're very approachable. We're receptive, we're warm, we're nurturing, and in order to get to legitimize this business that we're in order to legitimize and normalize the cannabis use, it has to be made more approachable. And that skill set specifically is what I think is going to, being able to apply the approachability to the cannabis market is what's going to turn it all around.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I mean, Ashley, I mean, you're focused on this in a really particular way in terms of kind of creating standards that companies can be measured against in terms of how they approach things like diversity and sustainability and all of these things. And you're also a woman in the industry. And really the same question. I mean, do you feel like it's different here to be like a female founder, a female leader? Ashley actually co-founded the Portland chapter of Women Grow with me, and we grew it to be the largest Women Grow chapter in the country. And we did that in, 60 days? Like, it just amazing leadership and amazing community engagement and outreach. I mean, really inspiring leadership to bring people together, and especially women in a place where they would be recognized and respected as professionals in an industry that hadn't totally got that figured out. And I just wondered, you know, what's your experience of being, what's unique about cannabis for women?
I think not only for women, but also in Oregon and in Portland, Oregon, obviously we have this really grassroots and community-centered feeling here in Oregon. So I think as far as Women Grow goes, and myself as a female entrepreneur, it's much more receptive to our community because everybody wants to see progression in a positive form. And so I think that you made really good points about why women are well established in the cannabis industry, but I think specifically to Oregon, we have this grassroots kind of innate progression that isn't normal. And so I think it is adaptive towards women being involved and leaders. And once you have that establishment right there, then those women feel confident enough to step up and talk loudly and communicate to other women. And then unified, we all can represent the percentage of females that actually exist. So when you say there's 44% of women, 44% of women represented in the cannabis industry, that's great. But what's the percentage of women to men in the nation? I think it's 57%. So that's great, but let's go to 57%.
Sara, let's do some lightning round questions here. We have about 10 minutes left, so I want to get as many of the audience questions out.
You said the word legitimize. What to you in the cannabis industry is quote-unquote underground and legit?
Are you're asking me to say what is underground and what is legit?
Well, no, like at what point am I now bankable, so I'm legit? Do I now have
entity? You're never legit on the bank. Thank you guys.
I'm legit to quit, but I just want to know.
Well, that's a really good question, and I mean, certainly the bankable aspect is a big part of it.
Unbankable.
Unbankable, yeah. We're unbankable. We have a lot of resources that are afforded to other entrepreneurs and other industries. I'm sorry, did I say that? We don't have these resources that are afforded to other industries and entrepreneurs, and it's not fair. there's tons and tons of research of why this is a good product. States are coming on board, one after the other, and people are asking for it. This is something that the majority of citizens in the United States want or already use. So it's legitimizing it on that regulatory, governmental level so that we can not only have proper administration of the product, because they're, with the obstacles, it's more difficult to have safety measures around distributing the product or ensuring that the business is done ethically or that the product is grown ethically, especially when you compare it to other agricultural crops and things of that nature.
Right. Like an example of that is we're not eligible for federal rebates for the implementation of sustainable technologies to build this industry in a way that doesn't devastate the planet. That's crazy, We're going to build millions of canopy square feet of cannabis cultivation over the next 10 years, and it's going to be a nasty business if we don't have the ability to do that sustainably.
I had a question about the ethical cannabis aspect and with banking. Have you started a discussion with the financial industry about how you can integrate ethics with financial standards so that the industry is more bankable?
Are you
from a compliance perspective, right? So the part of the risk for the banks
is
a whole compliance aspect that they have to address, right? And that's part of
it. If I get a bank account, and when I get a bank account, and I've talked to Jesce, I have a bank account through Cascadia Labs, and that was, every year I had to get a new bank account, 4 years, and it was four different bank accounts. So with Ethical Cannabis Alliance, I'm having to re-register the name to ECA, because I can't use the word cannabis. I'm not even walk into a Wells Fargo and
right.
Use the word
so cannabis. She's a couple of steps away from working with a bank to use her system to legitimize the companies that she's representing so that they're more likely to get banking, which is not even there yet.
So I have to rename my organization.
Just because there's cannabis in the name.
Because, so when I go to Wells Fargo, I don't tell them. It's almost the first, so I went to Wells Fargo the first year that I opened Cascadia Labs in 2013, and they put me through the ringer, and we called ourselves a botanical analytical facility. Finally, we opened, and every time I went in to make a deposit, thousands of dollars in cash that smelled like weed. I'm not joking. I literally would spray it and air it out. And they couldn't write me a check. So I did this for 2 years. And every time I went in, I was in Bend, Oregon. This is a small town. So every time I went in, I was like the demon in the room. And they would open my account, and like their face would go blank. And it was this very awkward situation. So then I changed to Selco, and then they called me one day and said, you have to close your account. And so you have 2 days, and then they gave me a month. Long story short, so now with Ethical Cannabis Alliance, I can't be Ethical Cannabis Alliance. I'm going to be ECA in order to open up a nonprofit banking account. But now Wells Fargo has slightly changed. They're kind of like, don't ask, don't tell. They're not as stringent. If you don't say anything, they're not going to ask anything. Did that answer your question?
It did, yeah. Okay. And I guess there's still this massive divide between the banks and the financial industry.
It's bad.
Yeah. So I can't get a loan. Even though I have a wonderful business plan and a budget and something amazing, I can't get a loan. I have to find outside funders.
Thanks, Wolf.
I used to work for a major bank that's actually at the federal level where they have a do not. There's tiers, and cannabis happens to be at that level right now, and it's not a decision a bank could make if they're under that regulatory body. But that certainly is a major topic in getting cannabis off of that list. And there's a lot of activities that's taking place regulatorily to decriminalize, legitimize the business.
Yep, they just kicked off a congressional cannabis caucus in Washington. So this is now, this happened last week, right? 2 weeks ago. This is now a topic of conversation amongst a broad array of congressmen from both sides of the aisle who recognize that this is no longer a partisan issue, this is a states' rights issue, and this is a common sense issue and a public safety issue in the states that have legalized cannabis. And so they're working on trying to figure it out, and that's good news.
They
have no trouble collecting money from us. Funnily enough, that's okay. So you do your taxes really super carefully, and you expect to get audited. And you create these rather complex corporate structures that give you some forgiveness against something called 280E, which is a tax law that was designed to tax the mob on the proceeds of the sale and distribution of illegal drugs. Schedule I drugs, of which cannabis is one. So tax is really fun in cannabis if you're that geeky tax person. If you're an accountant, by the way, a good one, or like know anything about bookkeeping, right? It was one of the most underserved areas in the cannabis industry. We desperately need people with these skills and people who really, really get the rules and how to do good GAAP accounting. Those people haven't totally shown up in cannabis yet, and we need them super bad. We're under a huge level of scrutiny, and we're all going to get audited. So we need financial services. Sure.
My turn.
Go ahead.
Oh, we have one here. Sorry.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry.
So my question is, with all the other things going on in cannabis, with the money side of it and the tax side of it, how, as a business, when there's so many new cannabis businesses becoming available in the market, whether it be dispensaries or other businesses, how do you differentiate your brand and make it recognizable in this marketplace?
Jesce, you should go.
Yeah, I think that is the key question that every cannabis business is trying to figure out. That's it. How do you differentiate? How do you grab the right consumers? How do you grab brand loyalty? And I don't think anybody really has quite understood yet. I think one of the things Dyana mentioned was the fact that she realized that there's a lot of people coming into the cannabis industry that aren't, you know, used to the strength of cannabis nowadays, or are still a little bit cautious about entering the industry. And that type of product is definitely one that will differentiate from the rest for these types of consumers. I think that when you look at the demographic of cannabis consumers, it's one of the largest, or the largest, of any non-essential product other than like toilet paper or toothpaste, right? How many products do you know from kids all the way up to the elderly, and everyone in between, race, color, creed, uses cannabis? But it's also a very culturally specific product, right? You have different ways of using it that kind of sit in different cultures, or different application methods for different types of people. So I think understanding that puzzle, figuring out where you fit specifically and where your strength is, will help you really quickly to realize where you really fit and where you can potentially win and differentiate from the rest of the people out there.
Sara, we're right at 7, so I don't know if you had a final question for the panelists or wanted to close
yeah.
this out. I want to be respectful of time.
Yeah, sure, totally. I did have one final question, and it was, what would be your number one tip for someone wanting to enter the cannabis industry? Jesce, why don't you go first?
Wow. My number one tip would be, it may not be a good tip, really, but it's one that has helped me more than anything. Honestly, read The Alchemist. And I think any entrepreneur right out there who is scared about taking that step, or, you know, doesn't know what's happening after the first step, take that first step and then see what happens. Watch the universe open up. I think that, to me, is what I tell anyone.
Yeah, I'm going to stem from that too, is do what you know. So whatever is in your innate, and whatever you innately have, go towards that and then research the shit out of it.
My number one tip is don't take it personally.
What's your tip, Sara?
Go for it.
There you go.